There was a study published in April of 2024 that said that more than 50% of infants who present to the ER with bronchiolitis end up getting diagnostic tests and treatments that are not indicated by the guidelines. My name is Brandon Hunter. I'm a board certified pediatrician and pediatric intensive care unit doctor, and I've taken care of hundreds and really thousands of infants with RSV and bronchiolitis. So I know how important it is to establish a diagnosis and get on the right treatment quickly. So today, you know, we're gonna talk about just that. How do doctors think about diagnosing and treating bronchiolitis and RSV? So to start out, I wanna differentiate RSV and bronchiolitis. So RSV, remember, is respiratory syncytial virus. It's the virus that causes different types of infections depending on what part of the respiratory tract is infected. And so in this case, bronchiolitis is really your diagnosis. So when we talk about diagnosing bronchiolitis, it is a clinical diagnosis. And what does that mean? Well, it basically means that if you have the right story, the right signs and symptoms, and the right physical exam findings, and they're all consistent with bronchiolitis, then what you're supposed to do as a doctor is say, we have a diagnosis of bronchiolitis, and I don't need to send further confirmatory testing like chest x-rays or other viral testing. So what do those things look like? Well, what's a history that's consistent with bronchiolitis? Usually goes something like this, you know, the mom or dad comes in and says, you know, our older daughter was sick with the virus, I think got it from somebody at school, came home, and now our baby has had 3 days of cough, congestion, and runny nose. We've had some low-grade temperatures as well. And then, you know, just this morning, I noticed that she's now having trouble breathing or having work of breathing. So what's great about that history for bronchiolitis is, well, first, it sounds like a virus because viruses are very communicable, very easily transmissible. So somebody else in the family was sick, probably gave it to the baby. And then it sounds like the symptoms started as upper respiratory tract infection symptoms. So mainly just affecting the nose and the sinuses. Now, after a period of 1 to 3 days, it's progressed. And now it seems like we have lung involvement because we're having a trouble or a hard time breathing. So the history, we'd say, put a checkbox right there and say, all right, that sounds consistent with bronchiolitis. Well, now what about signs and symptoms? So when we see the patient, are we seeing evidence of lung involvement where we've got this stuff we talked about before, the grunting, nasal flaring, the retractions, the head bobbing, and those types of things, which really tell us that, okay, it seems like this infection has gotten into the lungs. One thing we didn't mention before is hypoxia. So this can be seen with, it's another sign that the lungs are involved, but can really be seen with a pulse oximeter. And one of the important reasons that if you're concerned your child has bronchiolitis, you've got to go to a doctor to get this checked. But basically with hypoxia, for all of us, we're walking around with essentially fully saturated blood, or it's fully saturated with oxygen. Hypoxia is when it is no longer fully saturated, and it's usually a good sign that the lungs are involved. So it'd be very weird for somebody to just have an upper respiratory tract infection, but have low oxygen levels in the blood. That normally only happens when the lungs are involved. And then moreover, you know, you have to use your stethoscope and actually listen to patients to be able to make this diagnosis. But if you hear the sound of crackles and wheeze, and the specifics aren't important, but they're basically just abnormal lung sounds caused by air trying to get in and out of these tight and occluded bronchioles that have a bunch of gunk and viral particles and debris in them. And it's important to note that when those sounds are heard, they're kind of heard all over the chest, not just in one part. And that tells you that there's a virus in the chest that's infected a lot of different areas in the lungs. So if you have that story, you have those signs and symptoms, and then you have that physical exam, what you should normally do as a doctor, if it's a otherwise healthy infant who seems to be doing okay, is you should just say, we have a diagnosis of bronchiolitis, and the guidelines suggest that you don't need to do further confirmatory testing. So, as it says here, most healthy infants don't need testing or chest x-rays. But, okay, I will say, I just went through all that, I was like, oh, you don't need to do other testing, but to be honest with you, I work in the intensive care unit, and pretty much all kids who come to me who have bronchiolitis have had that testing, and if not, I very frequently will get it myself. So, you know, am I just a hypocrite? Yeah, probably, but also there's some differences here. So there's times to test where if you have severe illness, being admitted to the hospital, or especially the intensive care unit, a lot of times as a doctor, I just wanna make sure that we're not missing something else. So, you know, all these signs point to bronchiolitis, but maybe, you know, maybe I couldn't hear perfectly with the stethoscope. I wanna make sure I'm not missing a pneumonia that actually should receive antibiotics to get better. Or sometimes, very, very rarely, you can have an unusual presentation of, say, a mass in the chest or something like that. Would be very, very unusual. And if you're not in the inpatient or ICU setting where you're very, very sick, it's usually just not worth it to do that testing. Some people may choose to do it, especially if you have other risk factors, like we talked about before, you know, if we're born premature, chronic lung disease, exposed to smoking in the home, or if it's just an unusual presentation, like, you know, the history didn't quite sound like a virus, or the physical exam, it's not normally what bronchiolitis sounds like. Those are good reasons to do extra testing. The specifics of what you can do to test aren't important, but usually you just get a sample from the nose or from the mouth, but essentially a respiratory sample. And the way we tend to test it at my hospital, at least, is to send what's called a PCR. Basically, all it does is it looks for genetic material from the virus. In this case, it's RNA for RSV, and tells you if that's present or not. The test that we send, there's a couple commercial ones available. We actually do one that tests for four things. So it's RSV, because it's common, influenza type A and B, so kind of two there, and then COVID. And so why does it test for these other things, the flu and COVID? Well, remember, when I talked about RSV, RSV is very similar to these other bolded viruses, where you do supportive care. There's no medicine that you give to directly treat the RSV. And so whether you have enterovirus, rhinovirus, paraflu, human metapneumovirus, any of these viruses could cause the common cold, they could cause croup, and then of course in this case, they could cause bronchiolitis. But the management doesn't really change, and so very frequently you don't need to test for them. But the unbolded ones from this old table, influenza and COVID, you actually would do something about it. So if you had severe influenza, you could give Tamiflu to actually directly treat that virus. And then for COVID, you know, most recently we've been using steroids and remdesivir, so dexamethasone and remdesivir. But again, that's a treatment that you can give to treat the COVID. For RSV and these other ones, you don't actually have a treatment to make things better. You just support infants as best you can. Okay, so we're focusing on, let's say, just like mild disease. And if people are interested, leave a comment. I'm happy to talk about what we do in the intensive care unit, but really focusing on how do we support children who have mild to moderate disease who are being treated at home. So I'll first say we're gonna go through, you know, one by one really quickly about what we can do, but let's also mention what we don't do or tend not to do. So albuterol is a medication that's called a bronchodilator, which means that it will open up the bronchioles. This is used in asthma very commonly. So you might say that makes a lot of sense, where we've got these bronchioles that are inflamed, clamped down, have a bunch of gunk in them, and so opening them up may make things better. In general, there's not a huge clinical benefit if you have true bronchiolitis to giving albuterol. And so the guidelines would say you really don't need to do this. That said, if somebody is in an outpatient setting and a physician or nurse practitioner says, hey, you know, I want to try it, then by all means, it's worth trying it. And if it makes a difference, then it's fine to use. But just remember, you know, no medicine's without risk, and there's some downsides. Albuterol is pretty well tolerated. It can make your heart rate go up, and then that happens pretty much every time. The infant's heart rate will rise a lot. Very rarely could cause, we call it dysrhythmia or an abnormal heart rate, but that doesn't happen too frequently in otherwise healthy children. And then it can really just make you kind of feel kind of juiced up or agitated. So there are some downsides to it, but if it makes the breathing better, you know, it's not a hill I would die on arguing that, like, oh, guidelines say you shouldn't give it. And then I'll say antibiotics are really not indicated. So this is a virus. Antibiotics are used to treat bacteria. And so unless you think that there is actually a pneumonia, separate bacterial infection on top of this, then really should not be giving it. And then decongestant medicines and cough suppressants are really never indicated in pediatric illnesses, so would certainly avoid those. Okay, so what do we do? Well, the first thing is, we said there's a bunch of gunk in the nose, a lot of congestion, and infants are obligate or preferential nasal breathers. They want to breathe through their nose. So keeping the nose cleared out is really important. There's, you know, two basic ways to do this. You can either use, I guess old school is probably the word, but you can either use the basic bulb suction, where you essentially push it in and then put it into the patient's nose or the baby's nose and then release it, and then it will suck mucus out. Or you can use one of these battery-powered nasal aspirators. So looking at which device to use, there actually was a study from last year in JAMA that looked at this question. And so basically, 372 infants came to the emergency department and received a diagnosis of bronchiolitis. They were well enough that they didn't have to come into the hospital, so were discharged home. And half of them were told to use the bulb suction, and half of them were told to use the battery-powered suction. So the first critical thing is that there was no difference in the clinical outcome. So kids didn't come back to the ER more frequently, get admitted more frequently, have a longer longer illness or anything like that. So both of the devices were effective. But they did say that the parents who were in the minimal suction or the bulb suction group really didn't like it as much. They really preferred the battery powered suction. So what I technically recommend is that if you have the funds for it, then I would get the battery powered. It seems like people prefer that better, but it really shouldn't make a big difference in terms of the clinical outcome for your child. So if you're doing the bulb suction or don't have the money for it, there's absolutely no problem with just using that device. Two other things I'll say, the battery powered devices can be a little expensive. They're about 30 or 40 bucks when I saw on Amazon. And then whichever device you're using, make sure to put some saline drops in first. So just like 2 or 3 drops, and it really just helps to soften the mucus so that it's more effective when it comes out. So this is a chest physiotherapy or chest PT device. And the basic idea here, and you honestly don't need a device, you can probably just cup your hand and do the same thing. I hope this doesn't mess up the sound. But the idea is that we actually tap on the baby's chest in different places to help mobilize mucus and mobilize secretions. So to talk a little bit more about this, remember that we said bronchiolitis is an issue with the distal airways. So these are the small airways that are far out in the periphery of the lung. And they've got a bunch of gunk and mucus in them. So when a baby coughs, what they want to do is get that mucus out. But the problem is those airways are so small, and there's often atelectasis, where the lung unit is collapsed behind it. So there's no air, and there's no ability for the baby to actually expel that mucus and get it coughed up to clear the lungs. So this is why we do chest PT. What we're essentially trying to do is to break up that mucus far out in the lungs so that it can come towards the bronchi and the trachea, towards the carina, really, where all those things meet. And there, the baby can hopefully cough it up and swallow it, or cough it up and spit it out and actually clear the lungs. So what do we do? Okay, so keep in mind that you put the baby in different positions and you essentially just tap on the chest to help drain the airways. So if you're doing the upper lobes, you can imagine that it's best to keep the baby upright, because remember, the trachea stops somewhere down here, and so you really want the drainage to go with gravity towards the trachea, towards the carina here, so then the baby can deal with it. If you're doing, say, the right lower lobe that you can see in picture 5, then it would make sense that you actually want the baby on their left side, so the right lower lobe is up, and once again, gravity's gonna help you out and drain some of that mucus. And what you're doing is really just tapping on the baby's chest, kind of like this. Critical thing, just because some guy on YouTube shows you how to do it, that is probably not good enough. So this is a great thing that you should really ask your primary care doctor about, or ask a nurse about. I will say, in general, when I first started doing it as a medical student or a resident, it's more force than I really thought you would need, but very critical. You know, it should never really shake the baby's head, and then babies, in my experience, really like it. So if it's causing agitation or the baby doesn't like it, that might be a sign that you're using too much force. But yeah, talk to your PCP about it and see what they think. All right, so let's talk about hydration. We said in the last video that dehydration is a huge issue, and why is that? So once again, babies are obligate nasal breathers. They want to breathe through their nose. When they're feeding, remember, this is baby exercise where they're exerting themselves, and they have to coordinate this suck motion where they get the milk from either the breast or the bottle into the mouth, swallow, where it gets from the mouth down into the stomach, and then they have to breathe in between. So you can imagine that if you have bronchiolitis, where you're suddenly breathing much faster, trying to get oxygen in and carbon dioxide out, or if you have an occluded nasopharynx, so your nose is occluded, it's gonna be really hard to do this, because it all relies on being able to breathe really quickly in between sucking and swallowing. And so number one, this is why keeping the chest clear, sorry, with chest PT, and the nose clear with nasal suctioning is important. But number two, it's a reason that infants often may cough, they might gag, and they might actually just refuse to feed. So what I would say is, if you're having trouble here, this is another time, again, this is an educational video, but talk to your PCP. It's not uncommon for infants to have reduced wet diapers where they're actually now very dehydrated and need to go to the ER to get IV fluids to rehydrate. The only kind of general tip I'll say is doing smaller feeds more frequently is probably one approach that could help, so you don't get a big distended full belly and might let the child recover more quickly in between. Okay, the last thing is treating fever. So, you know, I work in the intensive care unit, and very frequently we have to evaluate patients on the floor and see, man, this kid is looking more sick. Do they have to come over to the ICU so we can treat them? And I will just say, in my years of experience doing this, babies look way worse when they are agitated and when they have a fever. So the work of breathing is worse, the heart rate is higher, the respiratory rate is higher, everything just looks bad. And once the fever comes down and once the baby feels more calm and comfortable, things often improve. So critically, you of course can give Tylenol and give ibuprofen, but Infants under 3 months old should not receive either of these, unless, you know, definitely not ibuprofen, but Tylenol even should only really be given if your PCP directly says to do it. And the reason is, it's often hard for us to tell how sick a baby is who's less than 3 months old. And so if you cover up a fever, that's a critical warning sign for us to say, man, maybe we need to do some lab tests, some imaging to see how sick this child is. And so we'd never want to give Tylenol and cover that up. Just talk to your doctor about it. And then with ibuprofen, you really don't give that until at least 6 months of age. And that's mainly just to protect the kidneys. And just to say out loud, never give aspirin to any children or babies. All right, so I'll kind of finish up on this slide, but basically, again, this is a YouTube video. This is for parent education, and so not meant to overstep or anything like that. At the end of the day, if you have any concerns or you think your child has bronchiolitis at all, you should be talking to a medical provider anyway, because that's their job, is to decide whether a child should be going to the ER, can be safely treated outpatient, and then when to follow up. But this is a great list of things that you should think about calling the 911 directly for, or your child's doctor if you see them. So I think that was it for the diagnosis and treatment. The last video I'm gonna do in this sort of like RSV series is talking about the new RSV immunization, Beyfortus or nirsevimab. I think there's a lot to talk about there. It'll be really interesting. So if you've stuck with me through here, thank you so much, and I hope you've enjoyed it. And I'll see you on the next one.